Hi, I'm Kirk Jowers, and welcome to the April 13th episode of COVID-19 with Dr. Russell Osguthorpe, MD. Thanks for being with us, Dr. O.
Good to be with you.
Following today's and Wednesday's episodes, we are discontinuing our regularly scheduled updates and FAQs. We will, of course, return when events merit additional episodes. Thank you so much for watching and interacting with us. Thanks to you and your kindly sharing these episodes with your friends. These COVID-19 episodes have been able to reach over 3 million people, and we're grateful for that. Let's look at today's graphic from the World Health Organization. There are now confirmed 1,773,084 cases and 111,652 deaths. Now, although the global death toll keeps climbing and we are ready to pass more than 1.8 million confirmed cases, there are mixed signals around the world. While some countries are seeing a decline in cases, others like India, Russia, and Thailand are now seeing a surge. We're also seeing European countries begin to take very different paths as they both adjust to their own policies and politics and also to where they legitimately are in the curve.
Yep, exactly. To be predicted, I guess.
To be predicted. You did predict as we started that we would see kind of rolling curves and rolling surges, and that's where we are. In the U.S., we have suffered the largest number of coronavirus deaths in the world with over 22,000 deaths. And for the first time in history, it's kind of remarkable anytime you say that, every state is under a disaster declaration at the same time, never before.
Yeah, remarkable that a virus is what does that.
Right. Now, nonetheless, there is hope. Some of the former U.S. hotspots, New York, New Jersey, Detroit, New Orleans, appear to be seeing a leveling off in cases thanks
let's
to social distancing.
Let's call it
efforts.
A softening.
A softening.
We're not quite ready to say they've peaked yet, but we're getting there, hopefully.
Okay. There's hope there. And many states are nowhere near the numbers projected just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
And so we're seeing their projected peak time now put out to the end of April, to May, and even some into June and July.
Fantastic.
Fantastic. And we're going to get into that in our last two episodes. Finally, the World Health Organization will soon begin large-scale antibody testing in multiple countries. And that's where I want to start and end today.
Sure.
Let's go step by step. First, what is an antibody?
An antibody is a protein made by the immune system in response to an infection that is designed to bind to the infecting organism, label it, or even help destroy the particular organism for which it was created by our immune system.
So then, what will this COVID-19 antibody test be? What will it entail?
So what the COVID-19 antibody test is designed to do is to look for the presence or absence of antibodies in the bloodstream of human beings to determine whether or not they've been exposed to the virus and created an antibody response.
So why are these tests going to be important for us managing the rest of this pandemic?
Okay, so these tests are really important because it gives us a better picture, not a 100% clear picture, but a better picture of what the true denominator is or the true number of infections in a population is. Right now, all we have are the number of positive tests, but we know from other countries that many people were infected and resolved their infection or were asymptomatic and never got tested. So an antibody test gives us a much clearer picture of the total number within a population who were exposed to and created an antibody in response to that exposure to the virus.
Let me get practical for a moment, and this comes from many of our viewers have asked a similar question. Once someone has confirmed through the antibody test that they have had COVID-19 and or tested positive for COVID-19 and is recovered, can she now go back to work and never worry about this again? Is she kind of a superhero amongst us?
This is a really important question. Having an antibody in your blood to any infecting organism does not mean that you are immune. But I would say that with most respiratory viruses, like influenza, circulating antibody can be protective to respiratory viruses. We are hopeful right now that antibody will lead toward long-lasting immunity. So, no. Having an antibody does not mean that someone can go back to work or act like they're Superman and totally immune. What it means is that you've been exposed to and created an antibody to COVID-19. It does not mean that you're immune.
Okay, great. That all makes sense. Let me ask two follow-up questions that are related.
Okay.
How long does immunity last compared with other coronaviruses? And I think I do know the answer to that one.
We don't know.
We don't know. Mm-hmm. So the next question is, when will we know?
Okay. So after we get a bunch of information back about who's been exposed and then follow that population for a period of time to see if they encounter the virus again, and then what percentage of those, hopefully zero,
right,
develop COVID-19, then that's when we'll know. But and that could be anywhere from a year to 18 months out.
Thank you. On Wednesday's FAQ episode, we will look at some theories about whether we should now be taking the opposite approach to flattening the curve. I'm sure Dr. O is going to have a very strong opinion on that. We look forward to seeing you then.